Okay, so solar cell structure looks like this. By the way, we spent two full course on solar cell. So one course on fundamentals, other is on advanced features. So there's a lot of material which I don't have time to teach, but I'm just giving a brief overview of it. So in the earlier drawing, your solar cell, how does it look like? You have p-type and n-type. Normally, this type of solar cell will never work. This is only the drawing. Okay, this type of solar cell will never work, or will give very bad efficiency. What will work is this. The junction is very thin. The thickness of the silicon wafer in which you start. Nowadays, the industry standard is 180 micron. When I was doing PhD, it was 400 micron, and before that, it was like 600, 700 micron. So people are going for thinner and thinner and thinner wafers to save the cost because silicon is expensive. Within that 180 micron, your junction should not sit at 90 micron, not in the middle. By the way, it is nearly impossible to have the 90 micron junction thick. It will take 1 month time to make a solar cell. To have a junction diffusion at 90 microns is really difficult. What people are doing is right now making a junction of 300 nanometer, 400 nanometer at best. And people are going for below 300 nanometer, 150, 175, 200 nanometer. Okay, so that is the junction depth. So out of the whole 180 micron thick material, your junction is sitting very thin at the top of the layer. That is one of the design parameters. People have done it. Then you have the starting materials called the base. Then you make your emitter. That is a junction. Okay, the current is in the industry, the base is of p type and emitter is n type. Okay, base is of p type material, emitter is n type. When the solar cell started in early 50s, the people were actually doing opposite. The base was n type, junction is p type. Then people have realized that no, p type base and n type emitter is better. Now people are again realizing that n type base and p type emitter is better. Okay, so now a lot of people are actually trying to make the same thing which people have tried in 1950s for some reason, for some good reason. Okay, but most of the industry right now is p type base, n type emitter. So there is anti reflection texturing. Okay, to reduce the, because if you don't do this, what happens? Absorption will be less. What is your first job? To absorb everything possible. So what does it mean? You should not reflect and it should not transmit. It should not reflect, it should not transmit. Third possible thing is absorption. Should absorb everything, and for that people do the texturing. The next job is, there is also anti-reflective coating. Okay, texturing alone is not enough or good enough to reduce the reflection. Then people also do the anti-reflective coating, ARC. Then there is a bus bar and fingers. So fingers are actually, so solar current is generated everywhere in your device. And the little fingers collects the current and then pass the current to the thicker line, which is called bus bar. And this bus bar is connected to the other solar cell. And that there is a rear side contact. Okay, so this is how the structure of the solar cell looks like. So when you talk about the design of a solar cell, we need to worry about each and everything. So what is the base material, how much it is doped, what is the junction, what is the depth of the junction, what is the doping level of the junction. How you are doing anti-reflective texturing, how you are doing coating, which material you are using for coating, what is the thickness of it, what is the composition of the material, are you doing surface specification or not, what is the, how many fingers you have to use, what is the width of the finger, what is the height of the finger, what is the width of the bus bar, and all this, these are all design thing. One need to design this depending on the requirement or depending on the constraint that you have. And so this is how your junction should look like, right? Is that clear? I don't have the actual solar cell with me. Maybe you will get a, there is a live visit and you will get a chance to look at the various solar cell module. I am sure many of you already looked at it. Then actually we have the p-type semiconductor which looks like this, n-type semiconductor looks like this. So we have the Fermi level in the p-type close to the valence band, Fermi level close to the conduction band. And actually in the December course we will go through the details of this also, so that right now we don't have time, but this is just introduction to PV, right? I am just going through fast. And then you create a space charge region. So there are like holes. So this is N side. These are the fixed charges, mobile charges. And because it is N side, N type of semiconductor, so negative charges are the mobile charges. You have the positive mobile charges and the fixed negative charges. This is a p-type semiconductor. And as soon as I connect a p-type and n-type semiconductor, what happens? There's a diffusion, right? The carrier motion of the carriers are particles in this case, from high density to low density. That always happens, right? So if the electrons are high in this number, they will diffuse at the other side. If the holes are high in number, they'll diffuse to this side. And so there's electron going that side, hole coming this side. But this process doesn't happen in finite time. It cannot happen in finite time. If it happens in finite time, you know what will happen? All the electrons will get killed and all the holes will get killed. We don't want all the electrons and holes to get killed. So what happens as soon as you sum of the electrons goes, it leaves behind a positive charge. Positive charge is basically what? Atoms which are sitting there in space, which cannot move. Electrons can move, holes can move, but the fixed atoms cannot move. So they are sitting in the space there, the electrons will go there, hole will come from the other side and they will recombine. Okay, so they neutralize each other. So what is left behind is a positive, a line of positive fixed charges and a line of a negative fixed charges. And by definition, this will create an electric field, right? A separation of a positive charge from the separation of a negative charge is electric field. The direction of electric field is from positive to negative. Okay. As a result, what will happen? If this is the direction of the electric field, if any hole want to come this side again, it will feel a repulsion. So holes are not allowed to come here. If this is the direction of field, the force on the electron is in this direction, right? The force on the electron is opposite to the direction of electric field because of the negative charge of the electron. So if electrons are going this direction, it will feel a strong force from that side. So after some adjustment, the electron cannot further flow to the other side and holes cannot further flow to this side, and the motion will start and you create a electric field in between. So that is our the property of the junction, that you create a electric field. And of course, you can do a lot of calculation to measure what is the electric field, how much is the width of the depletion region. If you have certain doping at the N side and P side, how much is the depletion region width at this side, and that's a lot of calculation you can do at this point. We are not doing right now. But the important thing is to look at the junction itself. Junction looks like this. What side is it, P side or N side? Those who are sleeping, please come back to the live mode. P side or N side? P side. This is N side. Okay. These are the holes. These are the electrons. Yellows are the electrons. Empty are the holes. There are four things happening. The fourth thing happens to your semiconductor all the time, whether you are putting light or not, whether you are biasing it or not, whether nothing. It all happens all the time. What are those? It is very important slide to understand again. So this is P side, there are lots of holes and there are very small number of electrons, right? From where these electrons are coming? No, you are doping, you are not doping, P type you are doping to create a holes, you are not creating electrons. But these are the generated electrons from the thermal energy. Some of the electrons have enough energy to go there, thermal excitation, minority carrier. Okay, this is N type, there are lots of electrons because you doped it and there are some holes also. This hole is again created because of thermal excitation. Some of the electrons actually gone there, left behind a hole. Okay. So there is a minority electron, majority holes at P side, majority electrons and minority holes at the N side. What can happen to these particles? What is this excess? Energy, and this is space. Okay. This electron, if you want to come down, can it come down? Can you go to the other side? Can this electron go to the other side or not? Yes or no? Raise your hands. Let us do the polling. If you think it can go other side, raise your hands. Anybody? No, right now I am not giving any other condition. Yeah, Rajesh thinks it can go other side. How many other things cannot go other side? Okay, you have to do some action. Okay, if you think it cannot go to the other side, raise your hands. Except Rajesh, everybody should raise your hands now. You have to do some activity, right? You cannot be neutral in this case. you have to do the voting. So you have to choose what happens. If it goes, it doesn't go. So raise your hands if it doesn't go. You have to really say that it doesn't go. Okay, other most of you don't want to decide whether it goes, forget about electron. Okay, look at this plane. Okay, it goes up and it's come down. What is happening? What is happening? So it goes up. Why it goes up? Because I am throwing it. I am giving it energy. Why it comes down? It always comes down to energy, right? Anybody, right? One common example is if I ask you to sit here in this room for another 20 hours, what will happen? You will go down in. So soon you will lie down on the floor, sit down on the floor, and after some 20 hours you will lie down on the floor. So that is the exact example what will happen to this electron. Anybody which is at higher energy level, it always like to come down to the lower energy level. Okay, so it, for this electron it is easy to come down always, right? Because coming down in energy, right? This is my energy excess, isn't it? This is my energy excess. So this electron can always come down because going down the energy, unless without additional support it can come down. What about this electron? Can they go down? Go this side? Most of them cannot. Why? Because they have to go up in energy. Somebody has to give that extra energy to them, right? But some of the electron which are at high energy level possibly can go. Possibly can go, right? Same thing is true for the holes. For the hole, energy increase or excess is this direction. So these holes, you know, because hole is having opposite charge in the electron, and therefore the energy excess for the hole is this direction. So this holes cannot go there. This hole can always come down here. So four things are happening. Electron can move there. This is called the drift because it's going under the electric field. Don't worry about that if you don't understand. This electron can go there because of the diffusion. This holes can go there because of the diffusion concentration gradient. This hole can come here because of the drift. This happens to your semiconductor irrespective of whether you are applying or light or not, you are applying bias or not, whatever it is. It happens all the time. Okay, but what we are interested, what happens if addition to this we put a light on it, in addition to this we put a light on it. So what is happening if you put a light on it? Because of the light, what is happening? Extra electrons are generated, right? Everywhere holes and electrons are generated everywhere. This action is in addition to the this action. Is that clear to everybody? This action is taking place in addition to this action. So therefore you have a lot of electrons generated in addition to this. Now we apply the same theory. What about this electron? Can get out to the other side or not? All this electron can go to the other side? Yes, they are going down in energy, so they can go. Can this electron come to the other side? No, they are going up in energy. Automatically they will not come, right? These holes, can they go down here? Yes, these holes can go there? No, right? So what is happening eventually? So these electrons can come down here, these holes can come down here, and eventually you see the negative charge being piled up there and positive charge being piled up here, and that's what? And this electron, once it is here, it cannot go back, permanently separated. This hole once here cannot go back, permanently separated. What you see here now? What is this axis? Space, physical distance. So what you see now? A negative charge and positive charge being separated from each other, and they cannot go back again. They cannot go back and come down here. And therefore, what you have done? You have done the job of solar cell. That is the separation of a positive charge and a negative charge from each other. Yeah. What will happen if you remove light? This will come down here. This voltage is there as long as there is a light, because this is a balance in the dynamic. This is a dynamic balance here. It and the static nature, this will not happen. As soon as you remove the light, slowly these charges are will come down within no time, and no time can be a microsecond or nanosecond. Is it clear? So this is what solar cell has to do. It creates a positive charge, negative charge here, positive charge here, and therefore this side becomes positive, that side becomes negative, and that is what is called the photovoltaic effect. This is photovoltaic effect, right? Is that clear to everybody? Again, very, 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 very important to understand this, because the whole design of solar cell, everything is this. When you talk about increasing efficiency, you have to worry about this. So where are the energy losses happening? Rest of it, okay, 33%. This electron going down the energy, it is required that it goes down the energy, loss of energy, right? This electron is going, hole is going down the energy, that is required that it go, loss of energy. Eventually it has to go to the contact, so there is some loss of energy. So all combine this small, small energy, you come from 33% to 14%. So what is the challenge to the scientist or engineer to take care of each and everything? How is the generation happening? Are you reflecting any photons? If the generation happening, is there any recombination? If there is a recombination, how much you are losing here, how much you are losing at the contact, how much light is being transmitted and things like that. How much is the loss due to the series resistance, how much is loss due to the shunt resistance and things like that. A lot of things to worry about. The most important thing for solar cell is, of course, this happens and we know what, P side is getting positive, N side is getting negative. What is this condition? In PN junction diode, P side is getting positive, N side is getting negative. What is this condition? Forward bias PN junction diode. All of you know, right? This is a forward bias PN junction diode. Without looking at the screen, tell me that what is the direction of current in a forward bias PN junction diode? P is positive, N is negative, current flows from positive to negative. Everybody knows that, right? Is that right? Right? Okay. Look here, what is happening to the current? Where is the electron going? Electron is going P to N, which means the direction of current opposite, N to P. Where is the hole going? Hole is going N to P, which means the direction of current N to P. So total current is N to P. What is the bias? P to N. That is strange, isn't it? Isn't that strange? In your PN junction diode, your current always goes from P side to N side because your P side is forward and N is negative bias. Same thing is happening here, P is getting positive, N is getting negative, but the current is going in the opposite direction. Isn't it strange? For the PN junction, it is consuming power, but we don't want solar cell to consume power. Solar cell should give us power, and therefore it is very important that the direction of current is opposite of the voltage generated, right? And therefore, if my solar cell is operating, if it is here, the current is positive, voltage is positive. That is your PN, the curve of the PN junction diode, right? If current is positive, voltage is positive, I have a power consuming device. In this quadrant, current is negative, voltage is also negative. So power is again positive, right? Current is negative, voltage is negative, power is again positive, which means again power consuming device. But what do I want to create? I want to create a power generating device. So power product should be negative. So either it can operate here where current is positive, voltage is negative, or it can operate here, voltage is positive, current is negative, right? So where our solar cell is operating? We know the positive voltage because P is getting forward positive and N is negative. So our voltage is positive, which means and the current is negative. So where is the solar cell operating? In the fourth quadrant always. It has to operate in the fourth quadrant. Any device which is not operating in either fourth quadrant or second quadrant will consume power. But our solar cell is a power generating device and therefore it should operate somewhere here. So like this. So same IV, so because it is a junction, PN junction, the behavior is remain same exactly, except that there is a large negative current flows, and because of the large negative current, the whole IV curve is now shifted down to the fourth quadrant. Tomorrow also. Okay, so we have this condition. Okay, so actually yes, this is, forget about everything else, this is your solar cell characteristic. Everything else is same as the till here. It is a PN junction diode and you add additional component, which is this negative current, that's it. And this, the whole equation becomes your solar cell equation. The whole equation becomes your solar cell equation. Okay, so there are few parameters I defined. First of all, the solar cell equation, which is there in the fourth quadrant. Okay, now I have plotted inversely in the first quadrant. So what you see here is the current is positive, but actually, what is it? In reality, what is this? Negative current. Okay, keep this in mind. In reality, that is a negative current. So your IV curve now looks this. It's much simpler. your maximum power point is here. This point is your short circuit current, that is the maximum current that you can get from your device. Typically the short circuit current for the silicon solar cell is in the range of 30 to 35 milliampere per centimeter square. Then you have the open circuit voltage, which is this point, which is the maximum voltage you can get from your device, and typically for crystalline silicon it is about 550 millivolt to 600 millivolt, 0.55 to 0.6 volt. Then you have an open circuit voltage from this equation, which is a solar cell equation. You can put total current to be 0, that is the open circuit case, and you will get the expression for V, which becomes open circuit voltage this. Then you have the, the maximum power point, okay. So when you take the product of the current and voltage, you will find that the maximum power will occur somewhere near the knee of this curve. So this is your maximum power point, okay. You will, so you should always operate your solar cell here, and therefore in power electronics you will listen to Professor Fernandez sometime how to make sure that your solar cell is operating in this point, not here and here. If you make it operate here and here, you will lose power, or you will not generate as much power as it should be. So that this is the maximum power point, and there is a corresponding voltage at the maximum power point, current and voltage for the maximum power point. And then you have the fill factor. Fill factor is the ratio of IM, VM, that is the power, the maximum power, divided by ISC and VOC, that is ideally what you could have got. And it happens so that this is given by the fill of this. So there is one rectangular this, and how much of that rectangular is filled by the this actual curve at the maximum power point, and therefore the name is fill factor, how much of that is filled. So this is the actual curve ideally, and this light green is the curve you can fill it. So if this filling is 80% of this, then the fill factor is 80%. And it can be given by the ratio VM IM by VOC ISC, okay. And finally, the most important parameter is the efficiency, which is what the maximum power you can get, VM IM divided by the input power, that is the efficiency. And input power is given by what is called air mass 1.5 g. We will discuss it while discussing the solar radiation, I think on Thursday. What is Pin and how we decide about that. So input power is normally at the 1000 watt per meter square. And because of the relationship between fill factor and VMIM, you can also write efficiency in the range of, by in terms of VOC ISC in fill factor, okay. So that is the expression for the efficiency. You can do the quick calculation in the evening today. If you look at the typical number of ISC, VOC I have given, right. VOC for crystalline silicon is 0.5 to 0.6. ISC is in the range of 30 to 35 milliampere per centimeter square. Fill factor is typical in the range of 70 to 80%. If you put these numbers here and input power is 1000 watt per meter square, you will be able to calculate the efficiency, and you will see that the efficiency comes in the range of 14, 15, 16%, depending on the number you choose, okay. So that is assignment for you, homework. I will check before tomorrow start, before the lecture. Please do the homework, okay. So let us stop here, and I hope that is a quick introduction to the solar cells. Any questions? No? Okay, so thank you very much again, and let us break for the tea, and then you will have the next lecture.